So Dr. Lewis is a friend of mine, and we introduced him on Friday here, and yesterday we took a little break because he came to visit me. He wasn't planning to be here, but then right on the side, I tell you, well, I'll put you to work. You can't come here and not let other people know what the Lord has entrusted to you. So it was a day of delight yesterday. You know, we just visited a little bit, and I missed that baptism. And I don't like to miss baptisms. But we have one tonight, right, Tim? Yeah, Crossroad is baptizing some individuals there tonight, so we're going to celebrate with that. But Dr. Lewis is a man that has traveled around the world quite a bit, has ministered in Brazil quite a bit. And one of his legs of trips there to Brazil, I got to know him. He was stuck in the airport in Fortaleza, the city that my wife and I and the kids lived while serving full time in Brazil. And I got a phone call and said, "Hey, I have a friend there that needs your help." And he's stuck there in the airport, and then he got to get a new flight tomorrow, but he needed a place to stay. So he came to my house, and there started a friendship and a relationship that I believe is God-oriented. You know, his life and his testimony really speaks more than the words that, you know, possibly he could have spoken to me. His testimony is true, and he loves the Lord, and he wants to be where the Lord wants him to be and serve him in the fashion that he wants to serve. So he's not here just to fill it in a gap today. He took serious, and the Lord has spoken to his heart, and I want you to help me out to bring him here so he can speak to us what the Lord has spoken to him. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you, Father. I thank you for your purpose, and I thank you for your will. Holy Spirit, we surrender to you right now, and we ask you, in your aspect of holiness, that you saturate this room right now with the awe of God.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Father, do you take any distraction from our brains right now? Any concerns, any worries? Any thoughts of what the day is going to bring to us later? Holy Spirit, I ask you in Jesus' name, speak deeply in our hearts and transform us.
Yes.
Bring us in the light and the kindness and the goodness of the Lord, what you have for us today. Bless my brother as he speaks. His mouth is yours, his heart is yours, his mind and his whole body. So speak to him and guide us here, Father, what you have.
Thank
you. In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you. Honored to be here with you and to fellowship in the Lord and the great heritage of this place that has impacted so many for so long. Sometimes over the generations, we lose sight of the foundation. And that's been true throughout history from the beginning of time and certainly the day of our Lord. It wasn't long even after he was on the earth that people lost sight. And it's been the case. You look now at the Holy Land, the area where Paul ministered for so long, and there's so little awareness of the living Christ. And for all of us, we need to be reminded, to be awakened. And so the theme of the conference itself, But God, is really a reminder of God, not just any God, but the God who came to earth in the person of Jesus Christ, God in the flesh, Christ, the living Christ, here among us. Our theme throughout this has been about God and but God and the focus of God, and which only is possible through a connection with him by virtue of Jesus Christ. And he being our mediator joins us to God himself so that we become one with him. And in that process, we we go through our lives. We have duties, responsibilities. We have challenges, obligations, and these all within themselves create times of trauma, times of stress, and times when we realize our human limitations. And in the midst of that, there are occasions when, yes, we come to grips with the fact that whatever it is before us at the moment, the situation we're in, is impossible. And so I want to focus this morning about God, but the God of the impossible, and how we can, in our impossible situations, find God a present help, present in our lives, in our circumstances, in our problems, as one who makes all things possible. You know, Jesus was asked on occasions by the disciples in Matthew 19:26, and there they were troubled because what he was telling them, it became pretty evident that it was beyond their human ability. Impossible means it's beyond your human ability. It's beyond what you can do. You've done all you can do, and it's beyond you. And when they began to ask the Lord about this, it's like, Lord, who can possibly measure up to this? And Jesus, with man, impossible. With men, impossible. With humans, impossible. With women, it's impossible. With boys, impossible. Girls, impossible. It is humanly impossible. In the vernacular, we might say, there ain't no way. Sorry for our school teachers here. Nowadays, we get away with that word ain't, but back when I was, you know, that was a no-no. Hey, do not say ain't. But that's a reality. There's no way. And once we come to see that, we stand in a rut, and we're truly stuck. Truly stuck. The God of the impossible, however. Man impossible, God all things possible. All things possible. No limits with God. No limits. No limits. I want us to watch a video about a young man, perhaps I think around about the age of 13. This is a video, it's a song, it's a true story of what really happened, and the man singing it, it was about his own life. It's so touching to me, on the human plane, we look at his life and it's tragic, but the reality is, it's the tragedy of all mankind, because what it describes is of a young man whose father abandoned him, and then when he was 13, his mother went off with her boyfriend, and they were driving down the road, and he was in the back with his little suitcase, and she said, okay, we're in this downtown area, this is a good spot. They opened the car door, they said, get out, son. He got out, they said, goodbye, and they left. And here was this 13-year-old boy standing on a street corner with his little bag, and he had nobody, and he had nothing. Impossible. And yet through that situation, we're going to see in his song that the God of the impossible invaded his space. The God of the impossible met him at the point of his need. Jesus became real and alive and did a miracle in his life. And out of that came a young man who became a gifted singer whom God has used, and certainly in his own way has impacted many lives. Listen and watch.
Still feel the
Jesus was there all the time, and he loved him this much. He hadn't forsaken, he hadn't abandoned him. He was available to him. All we have to do is call upon the name of the Lord, and he loved him this much. A famous musician who wrote the song "The Monster Mash" became a good friend of mine. He had 8 gold records to his credit. And he said, "I thought I had all the friends in the world until my career tanked, until my money ran out. And then I looked around me and said, where are all my friends? We have many fair weather friends. They're here for us if we're for them. But when we're not there for them, they forget about us." And this man was so crushed because all his life had been around his successes and his wealth and his friends, but they're all gone. The God of the impossible brings us at the end of ourselves. It has to, because our human limitations eventually run out. Our human strengths, our human abilities, our human talents, our human resources, eventually it runs out. It just does. We may not think it does, but it does. And this man, Gary, was standing outside a building, and he saw a church across the way on a Sunday morning. And as he went out there to stand, he noticed the people just
crowded in all around, and they were all lined up to go into the church building. And he said, "There's something going on here that I've missed. I've heard about God, I've been around churches some, but you know, something's wrong." And then it dawned on him, this Jesus that I wondered if he even existed, much less if he cared. And he said, "Then I realized he's been there all the time, waiting patiently in line." And that became a song that he wrote. He was there all the time, waiting patiently in line, waiting, just waiting for us. And we as God's people, and those who have received Christ, those who have been born of God's Spirit, who have Christ in us, sometimes we lose sight of him. In fact, all too often we lose sight of him. And in the process of our day-to-day activities, we get so busy with the stuff of life, the mundane and the demands and the duties and the responsibilities of life, that we're oblivious to the Christ who made it all possible. And so we need to be awakened, revived. I was talking to Robert, and he made the comment that someone he had heard said, "Well, in order to revive somebody, you've got to be revived. You've got to be alive. And if we're alive, we need to be refreshed, renewed, restored. The life in us must be awakened and be released." You hear the knocking? We talk of the scripture, Revelation 3, "I stand at the door and knock." Yes, he does. The first knock is, "Let me in." And for those of us who have sense to see that he's been standing in line, waiting patiently, he hasn't forgotten us, he died for us, he loves us this much, we open up, we let him in. Christ comes in. But then what happens? We relegate him to the back somewhere. The back seat or the trunk or to a back room or a closet or somewhere, and we just sort of bring him out where we need him. And that's what we call helping. "Lord, help me with this and help me with that." But everything else we take care of because we're good at that. We can do that. We know how to handle it. But when we get stuck, we call upon the Lord. And, you know, he doesn't mind bailing us out of our problems. I was ministering to a lady who used to go to Fort Worth, Texas, a young lady, and I went to her house to check on her. She wasn't there, but her boyfriend was sitting on the front porch. And he said, "She'll be back soon," so I sat down beside him. I'm just sitting there. And he kind of goes, "Wow, am I glad to be out?" I said, "Out of what?" He said, "Out of jail." He said, "This is the third time I was in," and he said, "This time nobody wanted to bail me out." And he said, "I was sitting there for days, and I kept thinking, I'm never going to get out." And he said, "Finally, I got desperate." So he said, "You know what I did?" I said, "No, what?" He said, I prayed to God. He said, "I prayed to him in the past for other stuff. It didn't happen, but I figured, can't hurt, and I had no other place to go, and nobody else to look to, so I'm praying to God." The bail bondsman came, and the person in the jail cell next to him got released. The bail bondsman walked past the door of his cell, and he said, "What are you aiming for?" The guy told him, and he looked it up, and he said, "Yeah, you've got a bad track record here." He said, "But I'm going to take a chance on you, and I'm going to bail you out." So he said, "That's why I'm here." I said, "No, no. Why you're here is because God answered your prayer. God bailed you out." Yeah. But not out of a jail cell. He bailed you out to show you that he's bailed you out of the prison you're in, because we're all prisoners. We're prisoners, slaves of the devil, imprisoned in sin, in bondage to sin. An evil nature has encompassed us and consumed us and overwhelms us, and we don't know a thing, and yet we think we know everything.
Right.
And I began to talk to him about this, and pretty soon he said, "You know, I need the Lord. I mean, I need Jesus. I just thought I needed him to bail me out, but now I see I need him to come in and take over. That'll get me out of all my messes." Yes, it will. So at that point, he recognized Jesus died on the cross for his sins, was more than glad to get his forgiveness and accept Jesus. So the Lord Jesus come in change me from the inside out and make me a new person. And the Lord did it. The Lord did it. Amen. This is the God of the impossible. We're talking about a present help. Not a God far removed from us in heaven way out there somewhere, but the living Christ here and now in our midst, available to us, and for those who have received him right here within us. God's not far from you. You don't need to be praying, Lord, be near me, be with me. I need to get closer to you. No, you don't. If you've received Christ, if you have said to the Lord Jesus, come into my heart, come into my life, I give myself to you. He came in. He is in you. He is in you. Never, ever to leave you. Never, ever to forsake you. Christ is in you now. And he's here for you now. But our part, you're knocking. He's knocking. Let me out, he says. Turn me loose. Let me do in you what I came to do. Let me live my life through you as only I can do.
Yes.
As only I can do. It's his life, and we must let him live it. Amen. And he came in to come out, not to leave us, but to live his life through us. This is the Christ who lived and died and rose again. And he is here for you. He's here for you. He's here for you. The God of the impossible. Yes, Jesus said, with man it is impossible, because in fact it is completely impossible. You know, in reading and studying about Lehr and the early days of the Bible camp, when it first began early on, they had a theme verse. A theme verse. Hebrews 13:8. Jesus Christ, the same, yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. Jesus Christ, the same. And we say, we hear that verse, and we say, yeah, that's true. Yeah, I believe that. But do we really? Because most of the time, for most of us, we act as if he's not the same today. And we carry on as we know in our own way, doing our own thing, and then occasionally we reflect back. And we sometimes are stuck like Jacob was, as he kept praying through his struggle and through his problems and his impossibilities. He kept praying, the God of my father Abraham, the God of my father Isaac, but not my God. Even though God had come to him and spoke to him and said, I am here and I'm for you, and I will take care of you. But he couldn't get it. God said it. And as many of us, I'm sure intellectually, he believed it. But experientially, in the crisis and the problems of life and the impossibilities, where is God? Well, he's the God of my fathers. I pray to him. But you and I must come to a conscious realization that God is in me through the person of Jesus Christ, that he who was the God of history past, the God of the apostles, the God of the great saints that went before us, the God of all those who have been in this marvelous place to worship him in spirit and in truth, is in fact our God too, because of Jesus Christ. And that God who was once far from us is now present in us and available to us through Jesus Christ the Lord. The Apostle Paul, describing the various aspects of human impossibilities, went through on several occasions various things that he had encountered. But in one place, he kind of summed up some of the most prominent areas or issues that he and we encountered. I'd like for us to turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and look at verses 8 through 10. 2 Corinthians 4, 8 through 10. And Paul uses we, meaning himself, and all that us have experienced, because it's common to all of us. 2 Corinthians 4, but I want to focus on verse 8. Let's start there. He said, we are troubled on every side, troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. He's listed four major areas of problems, four major areas of human impossibility. Let's revisit those. 2 Corinthians 4:8. First one he says is trouble. We are troubled. We are troubled. The story of Br'er Rabbit is a children's story that many of us may have heard as children. But in the story, it makes this statement, trouble, trouble everywhere, and there's nowhere to go. We can't get away from it. It's all around us, and we're troubled. And Paul is saying, we have been troubled. I have been troubled. Those with me together, we've been troubled. We, as the body of Christ, have been troubled. We have all experienced troubling situations. And then he adds, but not distressed. But not distressed. Sure, we're troubled, but the trouble doesn't get us down. The trouble doesn't wear us down. The trouble doesn't tear us down. And yet for most of us, and sad to say most of us Christians, trouble does in fact create a distress within us. Trouble in fact does wear us down, tear us down, and get us down. And it should not be that way, because in fact we have the one who is almighty, resident in us, to take care of us, and yet we're still in distress, as if he's not here. Lord, be with me. Lord, take care of me. Lord, do this for me, this and that. And he's already here. And he's, let me out, and I'll do it. That's what I'm here for. Let me out. Turn me loose. About 5 years ago, my wife and I moved to a new house, a different house for us. Not brand new, but new to us. We relocated to be close to our daughter and her family, and like 5 minutes away, that's pretty close. She wanted us in her backyard, but of course, building codes and space wouldn't allow that, but this is as good as it gets. So 5 minutes away, we're in this house. We've been there about a month, and we're still in boxes, you know, they're everywhere, and if you've ever had to move, you understand what that can be like. And during that month, my wife every day would say, I can't find the ledger, because my wife is the administrator for Source Ministries, and she takes care of the bookkeeping and all the financials. And she said, I'm still looking for my ledger. Every day she would say this, and we would pray the Lord show us, and so every day we just are thanking God that in his time and his way we would have what we needed. And for you that know about financial matters and nonprofit corporations, the government is serious about making sure that we do what we're called to do and that we have proper care of our finances. So we have to answer them. And so this is the place where all of our financial information is stored in this book. And she still keeps hers in a book, not in the computer, although she does a little of both now, but she couldn't find it. So she's looking here and there, and as every day would pass, it was not there. Then after about a month, it was raining one day, and so I was taking a break from my other activities, and I went up to our storeroom, which was next to my office, and the storeroom, we had just boxes and miscellaneous stuff just piled everywhere, and so I went in there. When I walked in and turned on the light, I saw water dripping. We had some of that on Renato's porch, and it was dripping down on his chairs where we were sitting, so we managed to maneuver around that. And so I called Lou to come help, and she was bringing towels and moving boxes, and thank God nothing of importance got damaged or ruined. But in the process of moving around the boxes, she saw this box and she said, where does this box? And I said, well, I don't know anything about any of these boxes, actually. That were all supposed to be storage, you know, just stuff we didn't really need right now. she opened the box and, you know, there it was, the ledger. The rain, the leak in the roof, was in fact God's opportunity to make us aware of something we were looking for. And we just needed to have a leak in the roof so we could take time to clean up some water so we could look around and find the box that had, in fact, she said, I don't even know how it got in there, why it's in there. It should not have been there, but it was. And the Lord knew it. And so that which would have normally been troubling and overwhelming was in fact God's opportunity. And because of the grace of God, we were not distressed during the process of finding it. But in fact, by the grace of God, we didn't find it. This is how God works. But Paul goes on to say, not just troubled, but he expands on this and it gets a little more difficult. He says, we are perplexed, and yet not in despair. Perplexed means you're bewildered. You don't understand. You don't know what to do. You're at a loss in terms of how to go forward and solving the problem or meeting the need. You're just at an impasse. And yet Paul says, sure, we're perplexed. It happens to all of us. Nobody's exempt from being perplexed. That's part of being a human in a world that's got complications, in a fallen world, in fact. But God. So he says, we're perplexed, but we're not in despair. It doesn't bring us to the place of hopelessness. One of my international travels, I've been privileged of God to be in 45 countries to train leaders, to preach and teach and minister and counsel to pastors, church workers, church leaders. And in Indonesia, while there, we had finished a conference at an interdenominational seminary. And after the completion of the conference, our next assignment was to go several hours to another big city, and then from there into a rural community into a Bible school. And we had already worked out the plan. We were going to take this shuttle bus, and it was going to take us to the big city, and then it was going to take us out to where we needed to go. Everything was fine until we got to the place where the shuttle bus was, and they said, well, we've had some problems and complications. The bus isn't going to be running today, and sorry about that. More or less in Indonesia. Of course, they're telling us the story. And the man that's with us, the vice president of the seminary, he's explaining. He said, I know it can be a concern, but he said, but we've got it worked out. He said, there's the primary bus comes a little later, and it goes to the downtown of this city of 1 million people, and it'll let you off downtown, and then you can find your way. But except we didn't know how to speak the language. We had no interpreter with us, and we had no way of knowing who to ask or where to go, or even, really, I wasn't even sure what the name of the place was we were going to go to. But I did have a note, so this vice president of the seminary wrote me down, this is the name of the school, this is the name of the little village you've got to go to, and this is what you got, and goodbye. So, there we are. Now, I have this pastor with me that's never been out of the country before, okay? Now, he's a great man. He loved the Lord. He was a wonderful man of God, but this was a bit much for him. He was perplexed, and he was in despair. He was. It's like, what are we going to do? I said, I don't know. We do it one step at a time. The next step, we get on this bus. He said, okay, but when we get there, you know, we as humans, and men more so, we want to know every little detail, how it's going to work out. So we got to have it all fixed, you know. And so I said, well, when we get there, we'll see what God leads us to do. He said, but how are we going to find this place? We don't know the language. We don't know anybody. There wasn't all these fancy cell phones. None of that happened. We're talking about 1987. So what are you going to do?
Wait on the Lord.
They that wait upon the Lord renew. Not just your strength physically, but the enablement to do whatever it is you need to do. So we're going to just, so let's pray. So he and I pray, Lord, I thank you for this opportunity. Thank you, Lord, that you're in me, you're in this, and you're going to get us through this. Now, Lord, we just praise you for the messages we have coming up, and we trust you to guide us now as we make our preparations. So we got aboard, and we're on the bus, and we're traveling along, and he said, but what are we going to do? And I said, well, and I opened my Bible, and I said, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to study and pray in preparation for our next week of conferences at the Bible school. And I said, I recommend you do the same. So he's studying. And all of a sudden he stopped and said, but what are we going to do when we get there? And how are we going to get out of this? And I said, brother, I don't know. But when God tells me, I'll tell you. And at this point, we just do it one step at a time. You know, the Christian life is called a walk. It's described that way by the Apostle Paul on several occasions. He talks about walking in the Spirit, which means being led of God's Spirit. He talks about walking by faith. And that means we just take it one step at a time. It wasn't until Peter got out of the boat that he walked on water. We focus on the fact the guy sunk. That's a minor point. I'm talking about a man that walked on the water. Have you done it? I have not. Hadn't heard of very many, in fact, haven't heard of any who've done it. But Peter did it. Peter walked on water. Of course, Jesus did it. See, but that was Jesus. But Peter did it. And that was before Peter had been made alive by the Spirit. That was for Pentecost. That was for Peter. He knew the Lord, but he didn't know the Lord. But he walked on water. What happened to Peter? And the rest of them are in the boat. But he had to get out of the boat. He had to take a step. And that step was a step of faith. At the moment he said, Lord, if it's you, bid me come. Just tell me to come. Just give me the word. You see, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Just give me the word, Lord. And Jesus said, come. No long, drawn out elaboration or explanation, just a simple word. A simple word. Come. You and I want all this detailed information. Not relevant. The only thing relevant is Jesus is Lord, and the moment he says, we do. I love how the mother of Jesus told those servants, the first miracle, whatever he says to do, just do it. Yes. And as they obeyed, a miracle occurred. Right. All they did was fill some pots with water. And the next thing you know, the water's been turned to wine, and Jesus did a miracle that nobody thought could happen. And in fact, nobody even considered relevant. Nobody needed that wine, but Jesus did it because his mother told him, just do what he says to do. He wasn't there to show off or perform or even to provide for them some wine. But the opportunity presented itself because somebody obeyed God.
Yeah.
Somebody took a step of faith.
Yeah.
And God is saying to you today, are you ready to obey me?
Yeah.
Are you willing to just trust me with your life? Because if you are, I will do in you and through you what you cannot do in and of yourself.
Right.
He is the God of the impossible. Christ in you makes all things possible. So about that time, my friend is really perplexed and distressed. He said, I just don't know about this. He said, I don't know. He said, I didn't sign up for this. I didn't expect it to be like this. Well, that's the adventure of faith. That's the way life is for all of us. Nobody's exempt from these issues that arise, these problems that occur, these unexpected things, they happen to all of us. So he was perplexed and in despair. And about that time, a woman, two seats back, a young lady, spoke to me in English. And she said, excuse me. She said, I hate to bother you, but I see that you speak English. And she said, I've been studying English. And I'd like to learn an English better. Would you mind if I practice my English with you? Now, the thing of the walk of faith is you just go with the flow. You take it one step at a time, as I've already said. So, sure, I'm just talking to this lady. We're having a conversation in English. And she begins to ask questions, as we're all inclined to do. We're just making conversation. Well, who are you? And this is my name, and this is your name. We exchange names. And where are you from? Where are you going? And, oh, you're going there? And I said, yes, but we don't know how to get there. And she says, well, there's no problem. I know exactly where that Bible school is. She said, my brother is a minister, and he's been there. And she said, I've been there too. I said, so you know how to get there? She said, yes, I do. I said, well, we don't even know how to talk your language, and we have nobody to talk to. She said, well, you have me. I said, this is good, because we need you. God's sending us. So we can get to where we need to go. She said, I'll handle this. She got up, went up and talked to the bus driver. She came back and said, $1. $1. And I go, what? She said, $1 each, and he will take you where you need to go. I said, well, but how do I tell him? She said, I'm going to ride with you just to be sure he gets there. Because he said he wasn't sure. He sort of knew where the village was, but didn't know where the school was. And she said, I'll ride with him, and I'll get you there. Wow. We have the supply before we have the need.
Yes.
This is our God.
Yes.
Our God has the supply because he is the source and supply of our every need. And resident in you is the source of life. Resident in you is the supply of all your needs. So if Paul says, my God shall supply all your needs, what does that mean? He will. So whatever your need is, however big it is nothing to God. That's why when David stood before Goliath, it was not some big overwhelming giant. All he could see was this big overwhelming God. My awesome God, our God is an awesome God. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord. And with God, all things are possible.
Amen.
All things are possible.
Amen.
So in the Lord, there's never, we may feel afraid. We may feel all these human emotions. That's being human. We feel all of that. We got up this morning, and even some of these big, strong North Dakota guys over here were telling me that it's feeling kind of cold this morning. We feel the temperature. And I know it's kind of warm compared to what it's going to be in a few months, but I'm saying we feel the changes in the temperature. We feel the changes in the atmosphere, in our spiritual problems, in our physical problems. We feel all of that.
Yep.
And that's just God's way of letting us know what the need is or what the problem is, so that we can remember who's there, who is in me, who's taking care of me, who's available to me, the source and the supply of all my needs resident in me, here and now. Sure, perplexed, but God made a way where there was no way. And we got to our destination on time. On time. And for $1 extra a person. Now that's $1 in American. She said she would give it to him in his whatever. But that was a time of perplexed and despair for my friend. But not anymore. No, he's way moved on from that. He's a awesome man of God this day. But Paul continues on to explain to us about these impossible situations. And the next one he says, the third one he tells us about, is in verse 9, persecuted but not persecuted, but not forsaken. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Now, there are many kinds of persecution. We've heard, even one young man gave us his testimony of being persecuted by some of his peers. We have all kinds of persecution. Some are verbal, and some people persecute us, but they don't give us what we need, or the other farmer doesn't help us when we need help, or different aspects of persecution. And then there are people that are literally coming against us and meaning harm to us, and some pretty crazy things that happen, and your house was robbed, and somebody, they were there to persecute you, but thank God he protected you. And so persecution is real. In 1988, as I went to Indonesia again, and we ministered in the Bible school, and then the leader said, we're going to go on Sunday to a church in a remote area several hours away, and it's down by the seaside and in a village. And he said, we have a man there that's he's ready to be ordained to the ministry because he now has a church. You see, in Indonesia, they're serious about ministry, and if you are called to ministry, then you have to be a man of proven character, which is to say, you've got to build a church. So, unless you have at least 30 people that have come to Christ, that have been born of God's Spirit, that are new creations in Christ, that are active in the church life and the body of Christ, they don't ordain you to be a minister. You've got to demonstrate that you are what God called you to do, doing what called you to do. So he was ready because he had 80 people, and about 50 of those have been walking with the Lord now for a few years or months, whatever it's been. So we went there. I'm sitting here, and it's not a finished building. It's got openings where the windows would be, and dirt floor, but it's a building. So I'm sitting there making preparation. The leaders are up there at the front talking and discussing the plans, and about that time, I began to hear loud noises outside. They intensified. They got closer. People are yelling. Some are chanting. Others are screaming. And it's intense. And there's a sound of hostility in their voices. And in my spirit, I sense evil. I sense evil. And I began to pray. And I said, well, Lord, what is this? The Lord just said, peace, be still. Okay, so I'm back to my study. It's like, I sense evil all around me, closing in on me, peace be still. So I'm at peace in the midst of this storm, and I'm at peace. But then about that time, the president of the school, his wife came over to me. She had traveled with us, and she whispered in my ear, and she said, you need to know what's going on here. I said, well, I know one thing, it's evil. She said, oh, yes, it is. He said, the sounds outside, she said, are from the radical militant Muslims. She said, our country is 90% Muslim, and they hate us, and they want to destroy us. And she said, in this region alone, in the past month, they have come to these churches when we would be gathering to worship, and they burned down 10 churches with the Christians inside. They set them on fire. And they stood around, surrounding the building, waiting for us to come out. And they would then begin to beat us and club us and try to kill as many as they could. It's already happened in 1 month to 10 churches. And now here we are. Now, nobody told me this was coming. But that's all right. The Lord knew. So she said that. Now, we must consult with the Lord about any and everything. Remember, we talked to some of the group earlier. On Friday, Philippians 4, 6, do not worry about anything, but pray about everything. So, rather than embrace the worry of the seriousness and the severity of the situation, the persecution that's now upon me, I simply talk to the Lord about it. Cast your cares upon the Lord, and he will take care of you. And so as I talked to him, I said, Lord, what do you say about this? She says they're here to kill us. She says I'm going to be burned alive. I don't like pain, much less to be burned, and certainly not burned alive. or beat to death. That doesn't sound good to me either. I mean, the options are not there. There are no options. There is no out. This is an impossible situation. I'm not talking to you about some theoretical concept here. I'm talking to you about real life situations. And it's an impossible situation. Persecuted, but not forsaken. You see, the Lord Jesus is the present help. He's present to meet the need and solve the problem. He's present. He's present. Lord, you are here. You are in me. You're going to take care of this. He's present. So I sit there waiting for the Lord to give me instruction. See, the scripture says, after we exercise faith, we have need of patience, that that which we have trusted God for and asked God for will come to pass. So patience means we wait on Him. I've been sitting there waiting. It's His move. It's His call. Maybe this isn't my day to go and meet the Lord. And certainly Paul said that's a better thing. But for now, it's more needful that I would be here. So then the thought came to my mind. You know, again, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So I'm sitting there and all of a sudden, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. Isaiah 58:16. No weapon, nothing that anyone can do against you is going to be effective. It's not going to happen. You're okay. You know, people often say, well, how you doing? I'm okay, but maybe you're not really okay. But you just say that because that's just what we say. But in the Lord, you are okay, more than okay. You're full of the joy of the Lord and blessed of God and mighty in spirit and strong in the Lord. Well, that's good. Thank you, Lord. So when God speaks, all the promises in Him are yes and amen. Yes. And so when He said yes to that scripture, I said amen to Him. Amen means I agree with you, Lord. I'm not going to agree with the circumstances. I'm not going to agree with what has been done in the past in this area. But I'm agreeing with you. No weapon formed against me will prosper. Doesn't mean I'm making it happen. No, it's what He's going to do. And I'm just simply agreeing with Him because He just needs somebody to stand in faith to believe Him so He can do it. And I'm just going to trust Him. Okay, have thine own way, Lord, we see. Do we mean it? Well, yes. And in a circumstance, we must allow Him to have His way. And His way is no weapon formed will prosper. How is He going to do that? I don't know. I don't care. It doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is Jesus is Lord in my life. Jesus is Lord in my circumstance. And Jesus is Lord over my problem. No weapon formed. But if that wasn't enough, God gave me another word. He brought to mind from Romans 3:4. He said, let God be true, every man proven a liar. God alone is true, and His word is truth, and He has spoken a word to me, and He's going to prove that they who think they have power over me, they who think they are going to destroy me and my brothers and sisters in Christ in this place, they are going to be proven a liar. And God who said, no weapon formed shall prosper, it's going to be proven true. And Jesus will be manifested as Lord of glory in this place, in me, and through my brothers and sisters in Christ. So I walked up to the front and spoke to the pastor, the leader, the president of the seminary, and the other pastors, and I said, I'm here with you. And they said, well, do you know what's going on? I said, yes. His wife told me. And they said, what do you think? And I said, well, I know what God has said. You know, what we think is one thing. What God has said is quite another. And what God has said is all that matters. I'll tell you what God said. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. And that's for all of us. And God is going to be proven true in this place. And they are going to be proven false. That's what it means to be a liar. It means you're the false, but God is true. You're the false gods, but God is the true and living God, and Jesus Christ is Lord. So we gather these six or eight ministers, we grab hands, we got our circle, we begin to pray and praise and thank the Lord for victory in Jesus. We sing that song, I love that song, and it is true. There is victory in Jesus. We stood, we began to worship the Lord as a congregation in preparation for me to preach and for the ordination service to take place. As we began to sing and worship, little by little, the chanting, the clanging, the banging, you know, I used to have garbage can lids, and my friends and I would use those for shields, and we would use them, and we'd hit each other with the sticks on the shield, and they would make the loudest clanging sounds, and these were the kind of sounds I'm talking about. But as we were singing, all that went away. And by the time I stood and took the Word of God and the Scripture in my hand to preach the Word of God, all the noise and the clamor, all the hostility, all of that was gone. Quiet and peaceful. And the word of the Lord went forth. The people of God rejoiced. Afterward, we had planned a meal. Now, you would think after such a horrific attack upon us, everybody would have fled as soon as the service ended. But no, in fact, they were just as peaceful and joyful. We sat around the meals in that building, and we rejoiced in the Lord. And a young man came in, and his mother was sitting at the table where I was at. He was the third mate on a ship, a tanker, and he had been in port for a few days, and he sat down by his mom, and he said, "Mom," he said, "it is so good to see you." And he just about started to cry as he said, "Mom, today I thought you would die." He said, "I heard the chants, I heard the screams, I came and saw all the militant Muslims gathered around, and they had their clubs and their swords and their weapons in their hands, and he said, today my mother will die, because I alone cannot protect her from this crowd. They're angry, they're hostile, and they have one thing in mind. The same thing they've done in the other villages. They're here to burn down the church and kill everyone inside." And he said, "I knew my mother's gone, and there's no hope. It's impossible." Then he said, much to my amazement, little by little, one by one, they just stopped and walked away. And he said, when they were all gone, I could hear the preaching, and I realized then what my mother said about this Jesus must be true. He, in fact, must be the Son of God. He, in fact, must be living and alive, and he is the Almighty. And so he said, "I had to come in, Mother, because I need to know Jesus." And me sitting next to him said, "I'm here to tell you about Jesus." And so as I explained to him about the love of God, the cross, and Jesus' death for his sins, and he began to realize what it really means to be a sinner. A sinner is not a bad person. A sinner is a dead person, and dead people do bad things because we do that which is of the devil. And nobody's exempt in that department. We all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But when this man came to that conclusion, he said he gladly admitted he was a sinner in need of a Savior. He needed Jesus. He said, "Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I give myself to you. Take control of me and fill me with your spirit and live your life through me." And he looked up at his mom and he said, I'm so glad that you did not leave, because now I have life in Christ. Persecuted, to be sure, some more than others. But what time I am afraid, the psalmist David said, I will trust in the Lord. Sure, I sensed fear, I sensed danger, but I also sensed the Lord. And I had the privilege of simply calling upon the name of the Lord, and he saved me, he protected me, he salvaged me, he spared me, he delivered me from evil which was surrounding me. But you know, the last thing Paul tells us about these different dilemmas, he says there in verse 9, cast down, but not destroyed. What does he mean, cast down? Does he mean he tripped and fell, or he just sort of stumbled or something? No, cast down, downcast. Why art thou downcast, O my soul, said the psalmist. David is saying, my soul is downcast. I feel depressed inside. I feel overloaded inside. I am in deep depression. I am downcast, discouraged. It's impossible. And in that impossible situation, we become depressed. It's like we are down and we can't get up. We know we should. Maybe even we could. You know, it's kind of like the boxing match, and the one guy keeps pounding the other guy, and he keeps knocking him down, and the guy keeps getting back up, and finally the referee's trying to tell him, just stay down. And even his manager over there saying, just stay down, but he tries to get up again, and boom, and he knocks him out. But you know what Paul is saying here is, you may be knocked down, but you're never knocked out. Because the one who is the light of the world in you has caused you to come alive in him. So yeah, you can be knocked down and you feel like you can't get up. But in him, you can. In him, you can. As I was returning from the Philippines, from Indonesia, from one of my international travels, I passed through Korea. It was supposed to be just a change of plane. Well, when I got to the airport in Korea, they said there had been some problems. In fact, they said, somehow we have too many people and not enough planes, and some of our planes have had mechanical problems, and so there's going to be some delays. Well, you know, we've all encountered delays. I said, okay, how much? Well, they said, we have over 300 people without seats. It could be as much as 2 weeks before everybody gets out of the country. I'm sorry, that's the best we can do. What happens now? I said, well, what do you suggest? They said, well, get a hotel room and stay till we get you a flight. And you're on the end of the list, like number 300. And, you know, there's no upgrades. There are no seats. Now, this was... This was 1986, 87, somewhere in the 80s. Well, this again, no cell phones. I didn't even have one of these things, I didn't have it in my pocket, these credit cards. I didn't even use them back then. I had my ticket paid for. I had been to these countries. I had some cash left over. I gave most of it away. I had maybe less than $100. I'd already given all I had left away to everybody where I was at. I didn't need it. I was going home. So as much as I have, I'm going to give. It's not about how much I have to give. It's how much I can give. I'm all about giving more and more, not less and less. Come on. I serve the living God. Amen. His well is never dry. Amen. Never dry. To say I cannot afford is the lie of the devil and is a disgrace to God. Because if you as a child of God think you can't afford it, you don't know my God. I'm telling you about the living Christ. He who has all and is in all. Afford should never be in the vocabulary of a child of God. That's not of God. That's of the world. God supplies all needs. All. And yes, all your wants. When your heart is fixed on him, psalmist in Psalm 37, trust in the Lord, and he'll give you the what? Desires of your heart. That's called wants. The desires of your heart. But your heart's got to be fixed on him. Your heart's got to be right with him. Yeah. And when it is, no problem. No issue. And so I'm hearing them tell me this and say, okay, so again, one step at a time. So thank you, Lord. You supply my needs. You brought me here. You'll give me home. Now that sounded good as I'm standing there at the counter. So I got aboard the little bus with all the others of us, and off we went to the hotel. Fortunately, God blessed me with a Christian couple that I was sitting by. So we got to kind of build each other's faith and encourage one another. And so we're talking together and everything's sounding great. In fact, they liked me so much, by the time we got there, they said, what are you going to do for dinner? Well, my thinking was, maybe I won't even have it. Because, you know, I don't know how much longer I'm going to have this money, and I don't know if I need it or not. So I said, I don't even have a plan for dinner. Well, join us and be our guest. Our treat. Wow, that sounds good. You know, you can only eat one meal at a time. Did you know that, of course. Only one meal at a time. So, my next meal is now provided. Give us this day our daily bread. He says that for a reason. Tomorrow he'll have whatever you need to eat, and the next day, and the next day, and the next day. Here we are today. Thank God for every day that we've had a meal. So I ate my meal. We're talking about how God's going to provide it. The lady was a flight attendant, and she and her husband were on vacation. And so she had to fly standby, which means she's even behind me. She's at the end of the line. And every time the line gets longer, she moves to the back again. That's a pretty serious place to be when you're stuck in a place where the line is getting longer, not shorter. But they were hopeful and certainly prayerful. So we all prayed together about God's provision. Went back to the room, went to sleep, or thought I was. But as I lied down in the dark room, it happened. It happened. What's that? Well, I began to feel that sensation of being downcast. First, it was just some mild discouragement. Then I started having this uneasy feeling. All the questions, the what if questions. What if I don't have enough money? What if I don't get on the plane? What if I have no place to go? What if I have no food to eat? What if? And suddenly, all the what ifs of the worst case scenario came crashing in on me in that dark, dark room. So the first thing I did is I got up and turned on the light. I'm going to see, Lord. I'm going to see what you're saying here. So I began to sit before God and just kind of get some guidance here, Lord. This is a terrifying moment. And by now, I'm depressed. I mean, I'm discouraged. I'm fearful. I'm anxious. I'm paralyzed. The depression is so intense, I could not even move. When evil comes upon you, greater is he that's in you. Greater, far, far greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. And I just kept sitting focused on the Lord. And then the thought came to me, get on the phone and call your wife. Now, a phone call back then was about $30 for a couple of minutes. But I didn't care how much it was, I had to connect with somebody that knew God, with my wife, who loved the Lord and loved me. So I called her. I don't even know what time it was, but I called her, and she began to talk to me. And I explained the problem, and I let her just talk. And in her calm and gentle and loving and soothing voice, thank you, Lou, she began to talk to you. And I'm telling you, I'm feeling it. It was a terrifying time. Terrifying time. I had nobody halfway around the world and no access to anything. It's a terrifying time. And you say, well, it doesn't sound like a big deal to me. Well, maybe it wasn't to you, but it was to me. And in the moment, it was very real, and the fear was very great, and the depression was intense. And she began to talk, and in her own way of wisdom, began to remind me of the truth of God's word, which I teach and preach and live every day. And as she began to share, faith began to come, because faith comes by the word of God. And she began to share God's word back to me. And I began to be built up and encouraged and refreshed, and began to feel that heavy cloud of depression lifting off of me. Then she spoke a word of faith at the end of the conversation. She said, it's okay, You'll be coming home tomorrow.
Wow.
It's like, whoa. All right. I'm coming home tomorrow. The Lord has spoken. I heard him through my wife. She prayed. We thanked God together. And she said, you're going to have a good night's sleep. Good night. I love you. And Jesus loved you. And so, bam. I went to sleep. I had this most peaceful rest. I woke up. There was a new day, a new sense of joy and expectancy. Today I'm going home. So I'm just in the bathroom. I'm shaving, you know, getting ready. I'm used to my hat this big, so I'm shaving. And I'm listening to my Bible tape. It was an old cassette player. I had the Word of God on the scripture. It was all on the tape. So I'm listening, and John is portraying the prayer of Jesus in John 17, and Jesus says, Father, I know you hear me. I know you always hear me. And then he said, I know you hear me now. Now. And as soon as I heard that verse, I turned it off. And I reflected on that simple statement that Jesus made. Father, I know you hear me. You always hear me. And you hear me now. And I said, thank you, Lord. I know that you hear me. And you have heard me. And you hear me now. That means, now means in this moment, in this place, the Lord has heard my prayer. And that means I have the answer to my prayer. So I said, Lord, okay. Thank you, Lord, for I'm going home. What's the next step? So I got finished, got dressed, and the thought came, get the phone book and look up the airline company, Korean Airlines. So I got the book, I looked it up, and had two main numbers to call. One was the downtown office with the main headquarters, and then one was the airport. Now the normal thought would be, call the airport, that's where the planes are. And on my dad, it was on Sunday, the Lord's Day, the eighth day of the week, the day of new creation, the day of new life, you know. It was on Sunday. And Korea, about 60% of the population are considered Christian, and they don't work on Sunday unless they absolutely have to. They worship the Lord, they go to church, which is all well and good, except I got to get a hold of somebody. And so I thought, well, no need to call downtown, they're at church. Well, when I got ready to dial the downtown number, the airport number, the thought came, no, call the downtown office. So I called the downtown office. And it rang and rang and rang, and nobody answered. And I'm about to hang up, and I got this impression, don't hang up. So I'm still going, rang, rang, maybe not 10 times, 10 rings, and don't hang up. So back to the phone, ring, 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 ring. I don't know how many, but at least 15 times the phone rang. And then finally, someone answered. It was the manager. She said, can I help you? She said, I wasn't going to answer. I'm not supposed to be here today, but I have some catch-up work to do, so I came in anyway. The phone kept ringing, so finally I got tired of hearing it ring. You wouldn't hang up. So I answered. So what? How can I help you? I said, well, I'm supposed to fly out today. I need my flight. I want my ticket or my seat or whatever I need here. I need it for today. She almost laughed, and she said, well, surely you know the problem we have at the airlines. There are no seats available, and there won't be for days. She said, where are you in the line? What wait on the waiting list? I said, I don't know, maybe around 300. She said, oh, well, you'll have to be here a long time. I said, but I'm supposed to go home today. She said, I'm sure everybody thinks that way. I said, no, I mean, I am going home today. She said, well, I don't know what else to do. I said, well, would you check and see if there's a seat available? So she typed stuff in and checked the airlines going out. There were two flights that day, one that morning, one that evening. Nothing available. She said, sorry, nothing available. And then the screen popped up and a seat opened up. A seat opened up while she's at the screen. She goes, huh, this has never happened before. She said, I can't imagine anybody giving up their seat when there's so many needing to get out. But she said, there's a seat. I said, well, that's my seat. She goes, well, you can have it if you want it, because I'm here now, and I'm one of the managers, so I can do what I want to do. Okay, sure, I'll give you the seat. So she does some things on the computer, and here's your seat number, and here's your ticket number, and this is the information, and you just take that and go to the main desk at the airport, give them that, they'll give you a ticket, and you go home. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. All right, so far so good on the story, right? So far it sounded really good, and it is. I got to the airport, showed them my information, they looked it up, printed me a ticket, here, you're ready to go. Wow, this is exciting. Then I went over and I saw the two friends that bought me the meal, my Christian friends that we had prayed for them. Now she's at the end of the line, remember? Mm-hmm. And so as I saw them, I said, but Lord, what about my friends? He said, we prayed. And they need to go home. They can't stay here. They don't have enough money. And they don't really know you that well. They don't understand how you work. And they're stuck. And he might even lose his job because he's supposed to be on the work. So I said, Lord, I ask you on the behalf of my friends. I said, when Paul was on that ship and you told him he would be safe and he wouldn't die because of that storm, when they were taking him to Rome to appear before the emperor, Paul prayed, and you gave Paul, everybody on board the ship would be safe. And I said, Lord, I'm asking for just two people. I'm asking for these two to get a flight out. So I trust you to do it in Jesus' name. So I walked over to my friends and I told them the good news and showed them my ticket. They, of course, were so happy for me and they rejoiced. They knew what a dilemma I was in. They knew I didn't have a ticket, and I didn't have money, and didn't have credit cards, and they knew I was stuck. I said, but I prayed for you, and God, I believe, is going to get you out too. They said, well, that would be a miracle. I said, I'm asking God to do a miracle. I got on my plane, went home. A few days after I got home, maybe even a couple of weeks, I got a letter in the mail from this lady. And she said, good news. She said, the most amazing miracle happened. We stood in line for the first flight and you got aboard, and we didn't. And so we decided we would come back for the evening flight to see, because you had prayed. And we believed that some way, somehow, God would do a miracle. And so they said, we came back, and we stood in line, at the very last, as they were boarding the plane and announcing the final call, they called her name. They called our name. And they said, come up. And they had two seats for me and my husband. And they put us on the plane. And we got home. I don't understand these things. I mean, I don't know the ways of God, but I do know the Lord. And I do know what the Lord did. And the same Christ that was in me, that was in them, did for us, is here for you to do for you. Cast down, but not destroyed. That is God's way. The Apostle Paul made an interesting statement about this at the end of the book of Acts, in Acts 20:24. He said, none of these things move me. None of these things move me. He's saying, I don't care. It doesn't matter whatever happens to me, whatever goes on around me, however bad it gets. He said, it doesn't move me. I'm fixed in the Lord. The psalmist David said, my eyes are fixed. He's fixed on the Lord. The scripture tells us to remain steadfast and unmovable. And we can in Christ by faith. He in me is the strength of my life. I in Christ am in the solid rock. And the solid rock does not move. Steadfast and unmovable in the Lord. This is Him. And what is all this possible? I keep referring to God Christ. But look back at 2 Corinthians 4:7. What did He begin the story with? We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. We have this treasure. And He's just been referring to Jesus Christ in the prior verse. So it's very obvious. Jesus Christ is the treasure. You're not the treasure, but you're not the vessel. You live in a vessel. An earthen vessel is, he's referring to your body, your physical body. We have a treasure in a vessel. You and I are spirit. We're made in God's image. And God, who is spirit, came into our spirit. That's why it says we're born of his spirit. So now his spirit in us, one with us, is our source of life. And so that's the treasure. Jesus called it finding the pearl of great price in one parable. And Jesus is that pearl of great price. He is the treasure. But he's in you. He's in you here. He's in you now. He's in you forever. Never to leave you or to forsake you. You have the treasure in the earthen vessel. The earthen vessel is weak, it's frail, it's flawed, and it's sin. But that's beside the point. The treasure is the point. The treasure is the focal point. And we have the treasure in these earthen vessels. And the excellency of the power is of God and not of us. So the burden of proof is not upon us. The burden and the demand and the pressure and the responsibility is off of our shoulders. Jesus says, come to me, all of you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Rest into your soul. Wonderful. Thank you, Lord. Amen. And we do need rest. A lady came to me in the Philippines one day after I preached, and several had been blessed with God to be healed as I prayed for them. She came and she talked about having heart condition or heart pain. And she said, I hurt all the time. My chest is in such pain. And she said, I just feel crushed by all the pain. She said, I just feel crushed. Now, I was going to pray for her for the Lord to heal her heart. And then God showed me that crushing sensation were like bands, and that she didn't have the rest because she was so tight, so tense, so anxious. So I prayed to the brother. I said, you know, I think you just need to relax and give up. You've been trying to hold your life together. And yes, you have Christ in you, but you need to let him live his life through you. So it's time to give up and say, Lord, I give up. I refuse to try anymore. I let you take control. Let you live through me. Fill me with your spirit. Live your life through me. And she did. And suddenly she said, the pain is gone. The pain on my chest, it's gone. It's like a load is lifted. Yes, he is the burden bearer. And he's here to bear your burdens. He's here to share your load. He's here for you today. And he says, I am the good shepherd, and I care for my sheep. Are you his sheep? Well, you are if you receive Jesus Christ as Lord. And if you are, and have in fact done that, then Christ lives in you, and he, the good shepherd, is going to take care of you. He will lead you in the path of righteousness. For his name's sake. Amen. He will. He will. He will. Your prayer, Rich. Your prayer. Lord, you are in me. You are in this. And you will get me through it. And you will get me through it. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's the same here. He's the same now. And he's the same in you as he was when you walked the earth. Or through the disciples and apostles that followed after. Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ.
Amen.
All to him. I hope. Trusting Jesus. That is all. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, Lord. But thanks be unto God who gives us the victory. Yes, Lord, we thank you. But thanks be unto God who has made us more than conquerors through Christ. In all these things, more than conquerors. We praise you, Lord, that you, the overcomer, indwell us so that we in Christ can overcome in every situation. Thank you, Lord, that you are the God of the impossible. And that the Jesus of the impossible, with God all things are possible. Emmanuel, God within us. Emmanuel, God within us. Christ in you. The hope, Christ in you, the source, Christ in you, the supply, Christ in you, your strength. Thank you, Lord. All I am and have is yours. Lord, I give up. I refuse to try anymore. Take me, make me the person you want me to be. Live your life through me. Fill me with your spirit. Jesus is Lord of all I am and have. I give you praise. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Glory to God.